I'm the co-founder CTO of this company called Goguardian. We're in El Segundo. And my 10-year-old cousin uses a Chromebook every day of his entire life. And he does this in school. He doesn't have any paper on him. And all of his exams and all the essays that he writes and all the worksheets that he does are through a computer. And when we were in school, we didn't have that. And we're seeing this as a major trend in education. Children are learning with laptops every day. And Goguardian is a company that really facilitates that and makes that actually possible by not only collecting data about what students are actually doing, but protecting them from the bad parts of the internet. So that's what we do. The general theme of this talk is insane growth with an insane amount of resource constraints from an engineering perspective. So this is January 2014, if you guys can see, and the right is roughly present day. As you can see, we kind of grow. It looks linear here, but the points where it's flat is really just summer. So it's very, very, very kind of scary growth. And I think we hit the 1 million student mark with 3 engineers. So lots of scalability problems. From an engineering perspective, what we actually do is we collect data about what students are actually doing on their computers. So when they watch a YouTube video, we collect metadata about like what the video is, what the title is, what the YouTube video ID is. And in aggregate, we pull all of these events in and show this information back to teachers and school administrators with the goal of improving learning. So as we hit the million student mark, we had engineered a solution that worked great for 10,000 students or 100,000 students, but we were having lots of difficulties at the million student mark. And Amazon Aurora announcement happened right around here, and we were absolutely thrilled because it was like a free 5x gain in scalability. And we couldn't really re-architect our data storage layer or our data pipeline with 3 engineers because we were still building features as a startup. So we were absolutely thrilled, and let me tell you how it ended up working out. And before I continue, if you guys have any questions, please like stop me in the middle. I'd love to make this like a back and forth thing. So yeah. MySQL, yeah. So we had built everything. It was a PHP MySQL monolithic app. We were moving really, really fast and shipping features. And the whole MySQL compatibility thing was kind of a very, very holy grail. So solid question. So I think the first thing that you guys are wondering is the performance boost is real. They're not just making up benchmark figures. And let me show you why. So this is a graph that we have in one of our inserting applications, like database insert applications. The red line is actually the 95th percentile insert latency, and it's amortized because we're doing bulk inserts. The blue line down here, which is essentially the x-axis, is the median latency. So you could see we deployed Aurora right here. And you could see the 95th percentile just drop, and it's like 1.88 milliseconds per record. And obviously when you're measuring medians, like you don't really see an appreciable difference. I think the Aurora team talks a lot about throughput, but we really, really noticed it on like the extreme ends of inserts and also reads. Here's another application we have. This is just a sample API endpoint. And we have, again, the 95th percentile in red. You can see the median jumping up a little bit to maybe 1 or 2 milliseconds, but it just drops. This is like the deploy again. So absolutely phenomenal for us from that perspective. Another thing is you guys should use read replicas. I think the Pinterest engineering team actually published a blog post earlier this year about how they managed to scale to I don't know how many hundreds of millions of users that they have. And they managed to do it with MySQL sharding. And it's a very, very, very good blog post. You should definitely check it out if you use MySQL or want to shard MySQL. But one of the points that they bring up is that with regular MySQL, slave or re-replica lag is very much a problem, and it results in issues like this. So sorry for the crude drawing, but here you have a vertical line representing time. So that's the beginning of time, and this is the end of time. And if you write foo equals one to the master, eventually it will propagate to the read replica. But if you perform a read of foo any time between when you make the write and when the propagation happens, you get an inconsistent read. And this is a huge class of errors. And we actually noticed this in prod when we were actually reading off the MySQL replica. And with Aurora, like, we're actually seeing tens of milliseconds of, or less than 10 milliseconds. I took this screenshot earlier this morning, like 2, 3, 4 milliseconds of replication delay. So for transactional writes, for example, if you're writing a bank balance account, maybe this is a problem. But for non-transactional writes, for example, if you're logging YouTube metadata, then this is less of a problem. Here's a spike that we have of, this is vanilla MySQL, and it's a replica lag that we have on RDS proper. So MySQL on RDS. And the y-axis here is actually in seconds. So it spikes up to well over 700, which is almost like 12 minutes of replica lag, which is absolutely absurd from like an application perspective. So we actually saw this is a real graph in production. And our customers saw this as well. Here's a snapshot of the maximum replica lag that we're seeing for all four of these read replicas here. And now the y-axis is not seconds, it's milliseconds. And it doesn't even go above 20 milliseconds over the course of, I think this is 3 days over here. So we're actually, this is real graphs and real prod. No benchmarks. So I'd like to rebut the Pinterest engineering team. If you're using Aurora, you should think about using read replicas, because the replica lag is really a game changer compared to regular MySQL. How many of you understand what an IOP is? How many of you understand what an IOP is in the perspective of MySQL select statements when you're an application developer? I think it's a very, very hard problem. When you go to provision a regular vanilla MySQL RDS instance, you get a little screen like this, where you have to allocate some amount of storage, and then you got to provision some amount of IOPS, and you're an application developer, you're writing these select and insert statements, and you don't really understand how that translates to IOPS, and I don't think anybody actually does. All you know is how many IOPS you're consuming for a real application, and then you just ratchet the number up 1,000, and yeah, you get a little bit better performance, but it's such an opaque metric. I'm really, really happy that the Aurora team decided to forego it, and instead, it's just 2 cents per million requests. And here's some actual real cost numbers for Oregon. The storage rate, as well as the IO rate, as well as like the instance rate that you pay. So yeah, that was a huge win. Another huge win for us was really fast failovers and restarts. This isn't really like a, I guess you guys do talk about availability, but we've seen failovers happen, and failovers do happen. It's silly to architect a system without the expectation of something failing over. And here's a real application graph. Here you have 712 and 30 seconds, and then I think this is about where the failure happens. The y-axis here is latency in milliseconds, so you see our API endpoint really, really suffering because of it. But literally 1 minute later, it is fully subsided. And I have a feeling that this is so wide because of actual DNS propagation and not necessarily because like Aurora is failing over. So I'm definitely going to check out that MariaDB driver, because I think that'll like even lessen this gap. But yes, failovers do happen. And in the MySQL world, whenever we failed over, like it would be minutes, sometimes like tens of minutes before things actually came back online. And It's pretty awesome that you can fail over a restart within like less than a minute. Final point. So this is less related to Aurora, but we really learned this the hard way. And I think if you take one thing away from this talk is don't write to your MySQL or whatever database directly, you should buffer your writes with Kinesis or Kafka. This was our original monolithic PHP MySQL application. And this is how a lot of startups get off the ground, and this is where we really proved our business value. But it kind of started to break in this situation. So over here, you have y-axis as incoming write throughput in the form of HTTP requests. So here we're ingesting data, so as students use their Chromebooks, we're collecting data about what websites they're visiting, et cetera. We don't really have any control over what's happening here. So it's just this big blue roller coaster. As time goes on, you have a real practical maximum of what your database write throughput is. And it's a finite number, and a lot of startups don't really hit it, or companies in general don't really hit it, but it's really, really important that you know what that ceiling is, because when it hits, how is your application gonna perform? Like, if you are forced to ingest all of these writes, like, what does your application do? And for us in this architecture, the answer was we just dropped the writes on the floor. And that is obviously not okay. So what we did is we push writes into Kinesis first. And this provides a bunch of wins, which I'll get to in a second. But for those of you guys who don't know, Kinesis and Apache Kafka are essentially distributed message queues or write-ahead logs almost, where you can write stuff into them in a very, very high throughput way, and you can have multiple readers that read off these streams and do stuff with it. So in our case, we're pulling hundreds or thousands of messages off this Kinesis queue and bulk inserting them into MySQL, or now I guess it's Aurora. So the Kinesis and Kafka throughput is obviously naturally much, much higher than MySQL as well as Aurora, because it's not doing any application logic with it, it's just buffering the logs. It's also very easy to add more data stores. So this was a very unintended consequence of our architecture design. We didn't really expect the use case of adding more data stores. Instead, we were very, very reliant on MySQL and Aurora, but we needed this buffer in the form of Kinesis and Kafka to deal with this dotted blue dot problem. And as a result, as a side effect of this architecture, we are able to just add more readers to our Kinesis stream and insert into other data stores. So now we're branching off into using S3 as like raw data storage, as well as other data stores like Druid. And it's all possible because we buffered our writes. And that's really all I have to say. So my name is Advait. If you enjoy this stuff, come find me afterwards. I have a whole bunch of Goguardian stuff here. So if all you want is Goguardian stuff, you can come say hi and I'll give you some. But yeah, thanks for listening. Appreciate it.